Well, hello and welcome to our online worship experience. Listen, we are so excited that you are joining us for this DV worship experience where we're going to worship God, hear God's word spoken to us through me. I'll be speaking the word of God to you today, and it's such an honor and a privilege. And so thank you for joining us. If you're new, a special welcome to you. And we just want to invite you to type in the chat there, "I'm new," so that way we can connect with you, follow up with you, send you a free gift just to say thank you for stopping by. We're so grateful that you decided to come by and see us. But now that we're connected, all of us together, yay, we're going to spend some time in worship. And I do want to let you know that this is pre-recorded. So you're getting this on Sunday during our normal service time. And so just so you know, we are meeting in person on Sundays at 11. When you're watching this on video at home, we're in service doing it live. So when you feel comfortable, if you feel comfortable, you're welcome to join us. But if not, you can continue to watch us online. But now that we're gathered together in worship, together as a DV group, we're going to worship God. And so if you would stand up wherever you are, would you clap your hands? Would you give a shout of praise to who our God is and all that he's done for us? Let's worship.
Oh, Marissa Tiela here with some morning announcements. First, welcome, welcome, welcome. All right, so my first announcement is our midweek. If you guys have not been coming to our midweek on Wednesdays, you guys are really missing out. It's an amazing time of just some prayer, some worship, some discussion, and just getting to know people at our church a little bit better. If you want more information, just send a message to our social medias and somebody will give you all the information you need so that you can join us on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. It's the place to be, guys. And my last announcement is that we're having a donation, a food drive. And we want to just be the hands and feet of Jesus. And what better way to do that than to share God's love in a practical way? So we're asking you guys to just bring in some non-perishable food items, some cereals, some pasta. They're buy one, get one free now at Publix. And bring them to the church, drop them off. We have a bin at the entrance. If you're not coming to church because you're just watching us online, that's okay too. Again, send a message to our social media. And we'll coordinate a time where either you can come or we can meet you somewhere and you can do the drop-off so that we can help the people here in our city of Doral. That's all for me. Have an amazing rest of your day and I'll see you guys next week.
Well, welcome back. We are so glad that you are with us. It is so nice to have you with us, joining us. I am so thankful to have you with us today. And so I just want to give you a heads up. I am going to, this is sort of like, I know you're watching me from wherever you are in your home, probably a lot, most of you, maybe on your TV or on your computer screen or on your tablet or your phone, but wherever you're at, I'm going to simply ask you if you would participate with me. There may be moments as we go through our talk today where I ask you to raise your hand, wherever you're at, just raise your hand. That way you're interacting. I may say, hey, would you say this out loud? And then wherever you're at, if you would do me the favor of saying that out loud, or I may ask you to read something. Something might come up on the screen and I'll ask you, hey, can you say that next part with me, if you will? And I believe this is just going to help us as we try to journey through together our online experience. It's going to help us connect a little more. And so I'm going to kick it off right off the bat by asking you if you've ever been needing to get on a call. Now that we're in this pandemic, you need to get like on a Zoom call, WebEx or Microsoft Teams call. You know you got to get on it, but you're not quite ready for it. You know, maybe you're still in your jammies or you haven't got your hair quite ready for it, but you know you got the call right now. So you log in and you get on the call, but you don't quite go all the way, right? You just turn on the audio, but the video, I'm not ready for that yet. I'm not even, you know, video call ready because I don't have the business on the top and the relaxed fit, you know, on the bottom. I don't even have that yet. So I'm just going to put on the audio and participate in it somewhat. Well, that's what I sort of want to talk with you today. We're going to unpack that a little more today. And let me just back up and say that we've been in a series that we are calling Truth Be Told. And if you've been able to track with us for the previous weeks, you know that what we're doing in this series is we're talking about people who say, we're talking to people who say that they believe in God, but truth be told, they don't live as if He is a part of their lives or He is in the center of their lives. They believe in God, but truth be told, they live as if He does not exist. And so we kicked off the series with part one where we titled it, you know, I believe in God, but truth be told, I don't know Him. And I subtitled that talk, Cultural Faith. And then in part two of the talk, I talked about how we say we believe in God, but truth be told, we don't fear Him. And I subtitled that talk, Customized Faith. And next, the next part, part four of our talk, so today we're doing part three, but in part four of our talk, I'm looking forward to it. We're going to call it, I believe in God, but I don't trust Him fully. Like, I believe in what God says, but I am not ready to put all of my trust in Him. I'm excited about part four of our series. But today, we're talking about part three. And in part three of our series, we're saying, I believe in God, but truth be told, I don't want to go too overboard with Him. Like, I just want to put the audio on the call, but I don't want to put the audio and the video go all in. And we're going to talk about that. We're actually going to look today in the book of Revelation. So if you have a Bible, whether it be on your electronic or you actually have a physical Bible, open it up to the book of Revelation chapter 3. And if you don't, it's okay. All the verses are going to show up there on the screen. You can just track along with us. If you're on your phone, this verses might come a little small, but hey, you can find the verses either way. So Revelation chapter 3, and I want to read to you from Revelation chapter 3, and I want to give you a little context of where we're at today. In chapter 3, in the book of Revelation, Jesus, well, actually in the whole book, Jesus is, he has addressed seven different churches in the book of Revelation. So he wrote seven letters to seven churches, or you could say he wrote one letter to seven different churches. Either way, it's pretty much the same. And so the guy who wrote it was a disciple, apostle, the apostle John. He wrote it, and this is what he says. He recorded the letters of the churches, and what's interesting is that in six of the churches that Jesus addresses, he has something good to say to them, and then he has something that he wants to correct and wants them to fix. But in one of those churches, he has nothing good to say to them, and he only has correction for them. He just spends most of his time in that letter talking about what they are doing wrong. You're not killing it here. You need some help, and I want to help you. And so to that church is what and where we're going to spend our time today. The name of the church is Laodicea. And let me just give you the context of this city of Laodicea. It was a very wealthy city, very, very wealthy city. As a matter of fact, 35 years before this letter was written to Laodicea, it was decimated and destroyed by an earthquake, but it was quickly rebuilt. And it was rebuilt bigger and better than you and I can even imagine. They had so many things inside of there. It had massive theaters. They had huge stadiums, lavish public baths, which were really popular back then. But they had massive shopping centers. Imagine this. This is like, you know, Vegas. If you've ever been to Vegas, just pops up in the middle of the desert, and it has everything that you know what? Even better than Vegas, imagine Dubai. Like everything you could ever wish you. I mean, roller coasters inside the buildings, everything you could ever wish for and want in the middle of nowhere, there it is. That is what was going on in this massively wealthy city, everything you could imagine. And this is what Jesus says to this very wealthy, very blessed group of people in Revelation chapter 3, starting in verse 15. He said this, I know your what? Can you say that? It's coming up there on the screen. I know your, just help me out, say it aloud. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. He says, I wish you were either one or the other. And so because you are what? Can you see it there? And this is our key word. He said, because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, he said, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. Verse 17, you say I am rich, I have acquired wealth, I don't need a thing, but you don't realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. He says this in verse 20. He says, and Jesus extends the most amazing invitation here. He says, here I am. I stand at the door knocking. He says, if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. Jesus is talking to the people of Laodicea, and he says, I know your deeds. Not I know what you say you're like. No, no, no. He says, I know how you really live, right? How we really live actually reflects the true reality of what we believe. And I'm not just talking about what you say you believe. No, I'm talking about how you really live. Jesus said, I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either cold, or I wish you were either one or the other. It's a little bit like coffee, you know. My wife and I, we love coffee, but we like coffee differently. I personally like it the right way, coffee hot, right? Coffee hot, that's the right way. My wife, on the other hand, likes it cold. We still have conversations about this, in case you can't tell. She likes it cold. And so, but you know, it's good still. But neither of us like coffee that's been sitting for 4 or 5 hours, lukewarm. Negative, not what we like. Coffee, so what is interesting is that if you study about Laodicea, they had some challenges when it came to their city. They're in the middle of nowhere, remember. And so they had water that was brought to them through these long underground pipes. And so they would ship water in from hot springs or from cold springs. And so what they wanted to do was they wanted to get that water in to the city as fast as they could. Why? Because they had no microwave. They had no refrigerator, so microwave to make it hot. They had no refrigerator to keep it cold. So what they did is they would get water piped in from these hot springs and bring it in as fast as they could, so they could serve the drinks at a premium, even at their religious festivals, right? They wanted to get the drink hot to the person, and if you were a VIP, they want to get it to you as fast as possible. If you were a noble person, a person who was wealthy, if you were, you know, a person in high class in that society, they wanted to get you that drink. If it was cold, they wanted to get it to you as quick as they could. And if it was hot, they wanted to get it to you as quick as they could as well. And so that was the challenge, though, trying to get the water in. Now, if you weren't a VIP person, you would be in the back of the line and you would get it not hot, not cold, you would get it lukewarm. Either way, even if it was supposed to be hot, you would get it lukewarm. Even if it was cold, you would get it lukewarm. And so when Jesus uses this language here, it was more than just, hey, you're lukewarm. He's saying, man, it's speaking to the fact that you really are not putting Jesus in the position that he should be in your life. I'm not that important to you, Jesus is saying. You're lukewarm. I'm in the back of the line. Your faith is not as important to you as should be the case in your life. And so that's why I'd rather you either be hot or cold, but instead you're lukewarm. So verse 16, let's look at it again. He says, so because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to do what? He said, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. And you know, it's interesting that word spit here in the Greek is a Greek word that's only used one time in the whole entire Bible. And this word Greek, this word spit, it actually means to vomit, to barf, to puke. It means to utter rejection. It means supreme repulsion. So I want to tell you that this past Tuesday, as a matter of fact, I don't know about you, but because of the pandemic in our house, we have designated Tuesdays as Taco Tuesday. And so this past week, we are sitting having tacos, and it was a great time. And all of a sudden, one of my young sons, I have two boys, one of them says, "All this cheese tastes funny." And, you know, typically, more times than not, the cheese doesn't taste funny. It's just my son or sons, either one of them, just acting their age and being picky. And so before I just do my knee-jerk reaction and answer to them the way I typically would, boy, you better eat that if you know what's good for you, I grabbed the bowl and I took a whiff. And let me tell you, it was repugnant. It was putrid. It was more than funny, it was disgusting. And so I just put the cheese to the side and I grabbed some fresh cheese and I said, "Here, son, you're right, have some of this." And so I don't know if I was like downwind or the AC was like downwind and it was, but I just went back to town eating my tacos, and like I would get like this occasional whiff of that horrid cheese as I'm eating my tacos until finally I couldn't take it anymore. And I asked my other son, I said, hey, would you mind, please, would you grab this cheese and take it to the trash? Just throw it out for me. And so I guess my son missed the whole part of it being funny. And he's like, why? And he grabbed it and he just took a whiff. And I saw his whole body just react to what he just smelled. And I was like, oh no, oh no, it's coming out. It's coming, he's about to do it. And so thankfully, he did not barf, he did not puke, but it made me think about the times that I have vomited where I've gotten food poisoning, for example. I don't know if any of you ever had food poisoning, but you know, it's the worst, right? Your body feels weak, your stomach hurts, you can't keep anything down, you can't even keep like water down. You try to keep water down and it just comes out in every hole that you have, you know, every which way. And I know that's a little gross, but hey, work with me, okay? I'm trying to bring a 2,000-year-old scripture to life and current, and trust the Holy Spirit to do his work in your life. So what Jesus is actually trying to say in these words that he is saying about this, he's saying, when you don't show any passion at all in your life, when you are complacent, when you are comfortable in your faith and you're not really pursuing, he's saying, I can't stomach that. It's like, I can't handle that. I reject it. I'm repulsed by it. From the deepest part of me, I cannot tolerate that. And I vomit that out. I spit that out. I spew that out. I completely and supremely am repulsed by that. That's what Jesus is saying. It's what the scriptures here is describing. Jesus is calling it lukewarm. Lukewarm. We claim to believe in God, but truth be told, we don't want to go too overboard. And it's this thing where I want all of God, all that God has for me, but I don't want to do everything God wants me to do, right? It's, you know, I want enough of Jesus that gets me into heaven and keeps me out of hell, but I don't want so much of Jesus that it makes me into one of, you know, those people that are fully consumed with all that spiritual stuff, right? Jesus calls this kind of person lukewarm. And he makes a point that it makes him want to vomit. It makes him want to, he cannot stomach it. It repulses him. And one of the reasons why I kind of can pinpoint with some accuracy what lukewarm looks like is because, quite honestly, I have been that at different times in my life, if I'm being very honest, very, very lukewarm. And I want to just be honest and tell you about one of those times where I was lukewarm. I remember when I became a follower of Jesus, I was all in. I was one of those obnoxious followers of Jesus. I mean, I had the shirt, I had the hat, I would, you know, pass out the literature, I would stand on the corner and sing in the downtown areas. I was the one that would go to school, and in my locker, you know, the lockers where you go to school, the lockers, they have those little vents. I would be the one that had like the bookmarkers that say Jesus loves you, and I would stuff them into the lockers and smile, and God is thinking about you. Just these, you know, I am the one that would walk into the cafeteria and, hey, everybody, get everybody's attention and interrupt everybody while they're eating and say, hey, just so you know, tomorrow morning, we're going to be at this room over here. We're going to have a prayer meeting. And so we want to invite you all to come and join us because God loves you and he has a plan for your life. That was me. I was this guy. And eventually, I got invited to serve at my church and got to step up in leadership. And I thought, man, this is what I always wanted to do. I thought it was the best, a dream come true for me. I mean, my goodness, I get to serve God in ministry. And I just visualized, you know, that this is going to be amazing. This is going to be amazing. You know, I get to have like Bible studies all the time with people, and we're just going to walk in like, and there's going to be like holy music playing all around me and swirling, you know, and my Bible will probably like hover over my desk and the pages will like turn, you know, by themselves, and sermons are just going to be written by themselves. And And it's just going to be great. And I'm going to be surrounded by people who believe in God and church people. And I'm going to be surrounded by all these nice people because, you know, church people are nice, right? All church people are nice, right? But what I learned was that it was hard work. It was really hard work. I mean, rewarding, but very, very hard work. And what happened to me tragically is that I let the ministry work replace my relationship with God. One of my heroes, I remember a mentor to me, pulled me aside and he told me this. He said, Abdi, the way I was doing the work of God was destroying the work of God in me. The way that I was doing the work of God was destroying the work of God in me. And I honestly, I would, you know, I would read the Bible only so that I could get develop messages. That was the only time I would read the Bible, is what, so I could develop messages from it. So whenever I was invited to speak, I could do that. I would pray only when I was in church, and I would pray in public. Those were the only times I would be praying, right? And so I would tell people, yeah, I'm praying for you. And I would if I remembered, but I rarely did because I usually forgot and I just didn't pray. And so I had everything nice on the outside, but inside I was really hollow. And the phrase that kept coming to me was that, you know, I've traded this full-time ministry to God for a part-time following of God. I've become this, you know, full-time minister, but I've become this part-time follower of Jesus. And, you know, you may be listening to this and you're like, well, I don't serve in the church like that, or, you know, I don't do ministry full time. Well, you know, that phrase may still become very real to you if I told you, you know, you've become a full-time mom, but a part-time follower of Jesus. Or you become a full-time businessman, but you become a part-time follower of Jesus. Or you become a full-time student, but you become a part-time follower of Jesus. And when I finally realized that, I started seeing Jesus's words in the book of Revelation as like, maybe that word lukewarm is talking to me. And I believe that there are so many people out there that maybe this word applies to you today. And Jesus is speaking and talking directly to the people in his culture. And I believe he is talking to a people in a culture that is very similar to ours, right? Where there is worldly wealth and so much entertainment and theaters and shopping centers and stadiums. And we have so much and so many parts of our world that it's almost like you don't really feel like you need God. And he said this, he said, you say I am rich. You say I have acquired wealth and I don't need a thing. But what you don't realize, he says, but you don't realize you're wretched, you're pitiful, you're poor, you're blind, and you're naked. And so about right now, I believe that some of you that are listening to this are feeling the loving conviction of God that he loves to do and he does so well. That gentle Holy Spirit of God is pricking on your heart and you're recognizing, maybe I believe in God, but truth be told, I don't know him fully. I'm not really committed to him. And so what do you do if that's you? Let me tell you what you do. It's real simple. You open the door, just like the scripture we just read, open the door to your heart and you invite Jesus in. It's that simple. You open up the door to your heart and you say, Jesus, come in to my life. Come in right now. Let's look at what Jesus says in verse 20. I'm going to look at it again. He says, here I am. Here I am. I stand at the door and I'm knocking. I am here. If you'll open up and if you'll invite me in, I'm ready to come in. If anyone hears my voice, listen, it's me, Jesus. I love you. I gave my life for you. If you can hear my voice, I love you. I'll come in and I'll eat with you and you can eat with me. Here's the thing. You don't have to get cleaned up first. It's like that Zoom call I was talking about earlier. You don't have to have it all nice, prim, and proper in order to do the video call as well. No, not with Jesus. This is the good news. You don't have to be perfect. You can just go all in. Just let him in. Jesus, come on in. Come on in, Jesus. That's what he does. He'll come on in and he'll just take you as you are and as you are, and he loves you because that's what he came to do. That's what he came. He accepts you. He accepts you. He doesn't leave you there. That's the beautiful thing about Jesus. He transforms you as you allow him to come into your life, as you invite him in. You become no longer the same, and you become a new creation in Christ. All the old is gone and everything becomes new. There are those of you who hear his voice, and you hear his voice, you just let him in. He's knocking on the door. He simply wants to come in. And if you hear his voice and you open up that door, Jesus promises to come in. And for those of you who say to me, well, Pastor Abdi, well, I've done that. I've invited him into my life. But truth be told, I am comfortable with my faith. I am complacent. What do I do now? What do I do in that case? Let me tell you what you do. Listen, when I come home to my house, to my boys, I have two little boys, as I mentioned earlier. When I come home and I open that door, I stand at the door, my boys, before I even open the door, as I'm, you know, getting ready to unlock that door, my boys start getting excited. And they start screaming and running around the house. And yeah, daddy's home. Papi's, what they say, papi's home. Daddy's home. They say papi, but oh, daddy's home. Daddy's home. Daddy's home. And so, you know, I open the door. I come in and I stand at the door there for a few seconds because they're still running around, right? But then they'll come over to me and hug me, and I love it. And I realize that, you know, they're young now, and as they get older, and you know, this is going to happen less and less, so I am milking this for all it's worth. I'm like hugging them tight, and they're kissing me, and we're snuggling, and I'm loving it. It's the best. But that's what you do. That's what you do. If you're like, I don't know what to do, you just open up the door. You say, he's home. I'm running to you, Jesus. I'm running to you. That's what you do. You want to get close to him. You tell him, Jesus, I'm here. I'm pursuing you. I need you in my life. Because when you seek him, he promises that you will find him. He's not left you. He is there. And you just run to him. What do you do if you recognize that you just don't know him? You just listen to that voice. And you open up your heart to him. And for those of you who do know him, but your love has grown cold, what do? You run to him too. You run to your Heavenly Father because he loves you. And he loves it when his children just, you know, they go to him and he'll embrace them. And he won't turn them away. He'll embrace them, and because you pursued him, because when you know who he is and you know what he's done for you, you crave acceptance from him, and you don't crave acceptance from the world, right? You suddenly just know that you don't need acceptance from the world. You want acceptance from God. Yes, I want you. And then suddenly you start sharing your faith all the time because you know that Jesus came to give you life and to give you life to the fullest. And so you know that in him and through the cross, there is forgiveness of your sins. And then all of a sudden, you recognize that what you own is really not yours anymore. No, it's not yours. It's a tool that God has given you to use to make a difference in this world. And you don't rationalize your sin anymore. Now you confess it quickly and you ask the Holy Spirit to transform you. Why? Because you are being conformed into the image of Christ. And you don't live for this world because this world is not yours anymore. You're not of this world anymore. And so you're on a mission. And that mission is, you know, that there is no part of you that will cause God to puke. You're like, no, I'm going for God. I'm going for God because you are on fire for God. You're on fire and he loves you when you pursue him. And so I just want to pray with you, if you would. Would you bow your heads with me in this moment? Amen. And so, Father, I pray today that by the power of your Holy Spirit, that you will strengthen our church. That God, in a world where it is so easy to be lukewarm and distracted by the entertainment and going online and all of the stuff that promises to fill us yet leaves us empty, God, we choose to run to you at the door. And we ask for your grace and your presence. God, we want to be in a living relationship with you, that we would know you and pursue you with all of our hearts. And as you're praying right now, I'm just going to ask it as directly as I can. Those of you who would say, yes, I understand who Jesus is, and at some point I committed my life to Him, and at some point I committed to being His disciple, to glorify Him with everything in me. But truth be told, right now, I see areas in my life that the Holy Spirit is convicting me of, and I want those areas to be hot with passion, to please and to serve Him. If that is you, I'm just gonna simply ask you, if you would, simply type in the chat right now, that's me. And just type that in, that's me. And you know, just be real honest. This is a moment where you could just be real honest with God, with us. This is a good time. It's an act of faith. You know, after a message like this, the question is, how can you respond? And this is a way you can respond. What do you do now? After you've heard a message like this, you feel that tug and that prick on your heart. This is how you do it. You type in the chat, that's me. And then I'm going to pray for you. And I'm going to pray for you right now. God, I thank you today for so many people who are under the loving conviction of your Spirit that transforms us. God, I thank you that we are not the same when you move us. When you move us by your Spirit to know you more intimately. God, we give you permission and we ask you to continue to show us and reveal to us any area of our lives where we might be deceived, selling out for something less than what you want for us. God, we ask for forgiveness and we ask that the power of the Holy Spirit would stir within us, that we would never be lukewarm, but that we would be blazing hot with passion to please you in all that we do. God, I thank you that because of this, in this moment, in your presence, that there are people who would eternally be different because of your Spirit. Your Spirit is working. Your voice is speaking. And God, you are transforming us to make us into the image of your Son, Jesus. Have your perfect way in us, God. We don't want to be comfortable. We want to walk by faith and not by sight. We want to please you, God, in all that we do. And as you keep praying today, there are those of you that are listening and watching this that you say, you know what, I might believe in God, but truth be told, I do not know Him. I recognize today that it is clear that I don't know Him like I should. And I need His grace. I recognize today that I need His forgiveness. And I recognize today that I can hear Him at the door knocking. And so if anyone lets Him in, He'll come in. And so there He is knocking on the door. There may be a voice that says to you that you're saying, you know, but I'm going to mess up. If I do this and open the door, I'm going to mess up again. Yes, that voice is probably true. You are going to mess up again. There may be another voice that says to you, oh, but you're not ready. And that voice is probably right as well. It's probably true. You probably are not ready, but you may never be ready. And you may never have another chance. And there may be another voice that says, oh, but you got to get cleaned up first. You got to get right first before you do this. And, you know, we talked about this earlier. It's kind of like that Zoom call, right? That you don't have to do. This is the good news with Jesus. You can go all in. He's at the door. Just invite Him in. He loves you. He does the work. He forgives you and He makes you new. So those of you that say, you know what, that's me. I kind of believe in God, but truth be told, you know, I don't know Him. I kind of believe in God, but I am not serving Him. I sort of believe in God, but truth be told, I recognize that I am not following Him. Today, though, I choose to follow Him with my whole life. Not a selfish version of this faith where it's like, keep me out of hell, God, get me to heaven. No, no, it's a God-centered version of faith. That yes, you say, save me, Jesus, from my sins. Yes, Jesus, I give my whole life to you. I want to be one of those who are all in, going full on with Jesus. Yes, I am saved by grace, but I want to know you and I want to pursue you. So today I want to turn from my sin and I want to turn towards you, Jesus. I say yes. And I, you can have my whole life. If that's you, I'm simply going to invite you to do me a favor. And in the chat, just type in, I believe. Just type in that, I believe, if you would. And as people are typing in, I believe, I'm going to ask everybody, if you would, please pray with us. Nobody here as a DV family, we believe nobody prays alone. So I'm going to invite you to just repeat this prayer after me, okay? And just say with me, Heavenly Father, forgive me for all my sins. I believe Jesus died for me and he rose again so I could live for you. Make me brand new. Fill me with your spirit so I can know and serve you and follow you for the rest of my life. My life is not my own. Jesus, I give it to you. Thank you for new life. Now you have mine. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Would you join me, everybody, church online, join me in worshiping God and welcoming those born into God's family. This is great. And so for those of you who just prayed this prayer, I want you to know that as your church, we are celebrating with you. There is no greater decision that you can make than to say yes to Jesus, be the Lord, be the Savior of my life. And so as your church, I want you to know that we're here for you. And I've got a simple request, if you would, if you haven't yet typed in the chat, I believe you can do so now. That way we can reach out to you, follow up with you, and help you with your next steps. What do you do now that you said yes? We want to help you, send you some resources, help you in this new journey with Christ. And so I also want you to know, come back, watch us again. You can watch this video again. You can watch us next week. We'll be back next week. You can bring a friend, because this is a little piece of heaven that all of us need right now in the middle of this pandemic. We all need a little piece of heaven, and this is that. And so I want to pray for you, and I also want to give you an opportunity if you want to give back to the ministry here, if you believe in what we're doing and this is reaching you and you know this is reaching others that you love. Listen, we want to give you an opportunity, and on the screen is going to show you all the different ways that you can choose to give. You can give by the Zelle app, by Cash app, you can text to give, you can go to our website, doralvineyard.org, and you can click on the tab that says give, and right there you can give right there online. Also, if you go to that website, doralvineyard.org, and click on the tab give, it'll give you all the directions that are on the screen right now, so you can do that maybe at your own pace, at your own leisure. But I want to pray for you. You know, because of your generosity as a church, we've been able to serve our community. We are getting ready to do, we're pre-recording this, so on Saturday, which would be yesterday when you're watching this, we did a food drive. And it, you know, our goal was to collect food from folks in our church and other folks maybe that even don't come to our church, but our goal was to collect food and be able to give to families. And I know that event was amazing. I know, because we've been doing it and we've done it several times and we've had a great response in helping people and also pray with them. And so because of your generosity, we're able to do that. And so God bless you as you give today. And so I also do want to pray for you. So if you would do me a favor and stretch your hands out to me, I'm going to stretch my hands out to you in this moment, and we're just going to pray. And what we're doing is this, we're doing an act of faith. We're believing that as we stretch our hands out to each other, God's presence comes down. There is something supernatural that happens in our lives. And so may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face shine upon you today. May he turn his face toward you and give you his grace. May he fill you to overflow with hope so that you can give that hope away to as many as you encounter this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen, we love you. Thank you again for joining us. I just want to tell you, remember, be a miracle. God bless you.